When Mike bought our M3, he noticed a bit of a crunch coming from the gearbox. And having driven it myself, I'm pretty sure it's the fourth gear synchro that seems to be completely shot. Now, on a car like this, a gearbox is a pretty complicated thing and needs a whole load of specialist tools to work on them. So I'm not even going to bother trying to fix it myself, but we are going to have to replace it, and that means it's going to have to come out.
So I'm stuck with this big and nasty job of removing the gearbox. The box is hidden deep within the transmission tunnel, and everything connected to it has to come off.
Wow, I have a lot of work ahead of me. Now, I've got to get this gearbox off. Everything's obscured by the exhaust. I'm going to have to undo the mounts that hold the gearbox to the chassis there. And, of course, I have to undo all the bolts around all the bell housing of the engine. And, of course, some of those are right up there at the top. So the exhaust is going to have to come off. But it's also things like this little clutch slave cylinder here. I might as well undo that rather than trying to bleed the system afterwards.
It's a pig of a job. And, naturally, the architect of this mess, Mike, isn't here to help.
This is going to take a long time.
To remove the exhaust yourself, you'll only need a few tools, and a ramp, like the one I have in the workshop here, really helps.
Although there is a middle section I could actually remove, I think it's going to be easier just to unbolt the whole exhaust in one hit. So I'm just going to have to disconnect all of those rubber mounts. And just because it's kind of heavy, I'm actually going to use a transmission jack to support the weight while I take it off, because it is kind of weighty. Now, when you're undoing things like these exhaust mounts, this is a really handy tool. It's very simple. It's just a handle with a little hook on the end. It does save you breaking screwdrivers and knuckles. Just pull that straight off. Job done.
A transmission jack is designed for just this kind of job, and it lowers the exhaust perfectly out of the way.
Wow, now this is heavy. You can really feel the German quality. Oh, wow. I think what I'm going to do now is undo this gearbox mount at the back that's bolted to the chassis. But to take its weight before, obviously, let it drop, I'm just going to grab this transmission jack, slide that in like so. I can then lower it down in a nice controlled fashion, and that should give me more access to all the other bits I've got to disconnect, including those bolts that go around the top of the engine.
With this gearbox mount off, next port of call is removing the prop shaft.
Now, I do need to disconnect that gear shifter mechanism, but of course I can't actually get to it until I've removed the prop shaft.
The prop shaft transfers power from the gearbox to the back wheels. You have to unbolt it, then slide it back to get it off the car.
Now, annoyingly, there seems to be a little gold-coloured bar inside the prop shaft there, which is actually stopping me just drop the prop shaft out of position where it is right now. So what I need to do is undo this extra bearing plate here, and then maybe even that kind of brace there for the tunnel, just so I can get the prop shaft out of the way and off the back of the gearbox. It's going on and on and on.
There we go. Okay, the prop shaft is out. We're making progress. Now I've got to unbolt the gearbox from the car. The next set of bolts are at the top of the bell housing at the back of the engine. How can you undo bolts you can't see? Enter my clever new toy. Thanks to this endoscope camera, I can see the bolts that I need to remove to release the gearbox.
So I've got this pretty cunning little thing. It's called an endoscope, and basically you can see it's got a little camera on the end with a little light on, and it's a little tiny thin neck that I can get into all kinds of crazy little places. So if I look into the bell housing, for example, I can see there, got the clutch slate, and then if I go a bit further around, I can see the edge of the ring gear there. You see the little cogs, the little teeth. So now, while I can see what's going on, I'm just going to get the socket into position. Oh, my word. Right, here we go. Wowzers, that was stuff. There we go, so. Oh, well, that is the last of the difficult ones. So now, just have all the other ones down the bottom of the gearbox.
So, with all the bolts undone, we're nearly there. We're about to get to the cause of the trouble, the gearbox.
Yeah, fantastic. Cool, so now the gearbox is all disconnected, I think. So theoretically, the gearbox should pop out, but because I've done all the easy stuff, we're not going to get Paul in to give us a hand, because I really don't want to drop this on my foot. So Paul, give us a hand for a sec. So we just want to prise the gearbox very gently off the engine.
At long last, after hours of work, we have a result. The gearbox has left the car.
OK, look at that. Well, that is pretty fantastic. We now have the gearbox out of our BMW at last. That was quite a lot of work. And now it's up to Mike to find us a replacement.
With the gearbox out of the way, it's on to those damaged alloy wheels. Alloys make a big difference to the appearance of the car, especially with these bad boys, but they need to be mint.
Now, these wheels are in a bit of a state. You can see they've been rimmed, they've been damaged, they've got quite a bit of corrosion on there as well. Handily, Mike has come to the rescue. He sent somebody down who can refurbish them while we wait outside of the workshop. So, I've got to get them off the car. Here you go, Paul, here's the first one.
Thank you.
So are we going to take the tyre off before you start working on the wheel?
Now what we're going to do, we're going to break the bead on the tyre so
okay.
we can mask it up and then reshape the edge.
Oh, I see, so just leave the tyre in place but just kind of away from the rim.
That's right, yeah.
Very cool, okay.
Okay.
The turnaround on our wheels is a couple of hours. If the damage was more severe, repairs back at their workshop could take days, so we're lucky.
All right, Paul. Oh, wow, look, so you've masked up the wheels.
Yep.
So well, how many more stages before we get to actually see paint go on?
What we're going to do, we're going to grind all this damage out, get it nice and flat, take all the rot out, then we're going to prime it, paint it and lacquer it.
Cool. That is really impressive. But what would one of these vans cost if I wanted to pop out and buy one myself?
Around about £60,000.
60 grand?
That's right, yeah.
Wow.
Right, that's all nice and smooth, so ready for some primer.
Cool. I guess safety gear is in order.
That's it, mask on.
Once Paul has applied the primer, he leaves it to dry under the infrared heater for 10 minutes, before finally adding some layers of metallic paint and, of course, lacquer. True, I could do this myself, but I'm not sure I'd match the finish of these guys, so at £60 a corner, it's decent value.
That is looking fantastic. Well done, that man. Look at that. That is going to look so good on our car. Thank you very much, sir.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Well done.
Cheers.
So now, I better get him on.
Now that is looking very tidy indeed.
Click here to subscribe.